The Swell Season Podcast is recorded by the Newsstand Studio at Rockefeller Center in the heart of Manhattan and is distributed by the Swell Season Surf Radio Network. Welcome to the Swell Season Surf Podcast. I'm your host for this episode, Tyler Brewer. Sean Duggan is a Los Angeles-based producer and filmmaker with over 20 years' experience in advertising and the entertainment world. His debut feature-length film, Keep It a Secret, recounts the inspiring true story of the dawn of Irish surfing and how the sport's brave pioneers found peace the surf during the most violent years of the Troubles conflict. It is the first documentary to tell the inspiring story of the surfing pioneers from Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland, who found in the exhilaration of wave riding an escape from the Troubles and a common bond that transcended the political hostilities and religious sectarianism that divided their countrymen. The film is screening at the Rockaway Film Festival this week, and Sean is our guest. Sean, welcome to the show. Super stoked to have you on. I really enjoyed this film. Irish surfing is definitely near and dear to my heart. I spent a bit of time there in the late 90s and early 2000s, and you know, I'd made some lifelong friends over there. So I've always really enjoyed it, and really cool to learn so much about the history of it.
Well, thank you. I'm a fan of the podcast, so thank you, and thanks for the kind introduction. And if you're available Thursday, maybe you can do the intro of the film, since I unfortunately can't make it to the Rockaways, and it pains me this Thursday. So, but thank you. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, no, I'm stoked. I guess what I loved about this film is that you can really track the history of Irish surfing. Like, it doesn't feel disputed or vague. It feels very solid. Like, so-and-so started here and this happened here. It's like all really kind of well documented, feels like. And I wanted to see, was that the case when you were researching this and kind of discovering the history of surfing there?
Yeah, well, it's when I started it, you know, I guess, hey, it's an origin story, obviously, yeah, as you articulated in the beginning. It's and you know, my keyhole in, you know, I'm of an Irish background, as it kind of starts off in the film, and I'm a surfer like yourself, and Rockaway was my primary break for many, many years. But it really started, like, you know, I guess the, in earnest, it started about, you know, 4 years ago ish, a little bit longer now, because it's like we finished it, the film, actually over a year ago. Wow. But you know, I was just like, I guess about 10 years, I had never surfed in Ireland, you know, as much as I was an Irish descent and I spent time on the West Coast. But I was like, you know, obviously with YouTube, you start seeing things. And I was just, you know, I started getting myself, you know, interested in, like, hey, taking on some film projects, because I've, you know, always had a passion for film, but I'd never really, I'd worked in advertising and media, radio, most of my career. And I was just like, when I was starting to think about stories, I was like, hey, you know what, I'd be curious to know what this story is. And that was kind of my keyhole into it. And then, you know, kind of fortuitously, I connected with some people. I got very good advice from my producer, Sabina Cryenbuehl, who is based in Brooklyn, a neighbor of mine. Nice. And she was just like, she's a pretty well-regarded filmmaker and editor in her own right. And she was just, I was kind of kicking around the kitchen. I was like, hey, this is an idea I have. And I think, you know, I feel like I've, you know, I was like, I'd be kind of curious to learn more about this story. And she's like, well, you know what you should do is if you go over there, any research you do, film it. And what happened was there was a 50th anniversary in Tremore, Ireland. This is 2017. This is like just when I basically thought of the idea in like July. Wow. And one of my first calls was to this gentleman, Roger Steadman, who I've now become pretty close with, who's a British executive who kind of quit his, asked for a transfer from Unilever headquarters, London, to go to the West Coast of Ireland. And I spoke to him and he was like, hey, there's a big reunion here in 2 months. And I think everybody will be there.
Wow.
And so you think about like, if this was a very independent, my first, you know, feature project, but like that kind of, you know, having all these, many of them still alive, which is very fortunate because they're in their 70s and 80s now in one place for a weekend. It just worked out well. And, you know, what I did wrestle with as you back to your question about the origin story, you know, as you know, with surfing stories, I don't care whether it's, you know, somebody finding a secret spot in Nicaragua, first person to surf Rockaway, you know, there's a lot of dibs. And what I made a self-agreement with myself. I'm like, I'm not becoming official historian of Irish surfing with this. And that's a thankless task. But what I did was, it did point to, hey, like there's a lot of people I don't cover in 60 minutes. But what I, like Kevin Cavey, who's this gentleman from Dublin, who's kind of one of the primary characters, he was widely recognized, you know, at any kind of Google searches, like that chief evangelist who helped shepherd it. So I kind of used him as the keyhole in as I started trying to find who those people are. And then I kind of let it unfold from there, you know, the story.
It's super cool. Like first, Tremor is awesome, by the way. How nice is it?
Beautiful.
I had friends who were part of the T-Bay Surf Club.
You know, okay,
they had
yeah.
That whole surf club right on the beach. Like at least when I was there, I remember they had like a fundraiser and then they built like a really cool clubhouse right on the beach where you can hang out and have events. And I was like, why don't we do this in the U.S.? This is awesome.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, and I think the first, I've done, you know, a bunch of media podcasts. The first host I've spoken to who actually knows of the T-Bay Surf Club, so touche to you, and been there, is, or, you know, kind of like, no, but yeah, it's a great, you know, it's the unfortunate part of spectacularly gorgeous, wonderful people, and one of the original crews there who I was lucky to get, like the Musgrave twins and Hugh O'Brien Moran, really a gentleman and a true ambassador of the sport. He's coached national teams forever, but hey, they're on the Irish Sea, which is probably more akin to what we deal with the Rockaways.
It's very fickle.
Hit and run swells, which is, you know, it's like which there was some great stuff that didn't get into the film, which is I think Willie Britton referred to them because those lads are surf starved. they get to Donegal and they're like, they can't get off a wave because there's such an abundance of embarrassment of riches in Donegal, Sligo, and compared to there.
It's so true. And it's funny, like, it's not easy to get across the country. Like, you look on the map and you're like, oh, that shouldn't be very far. It shouldn't take very long. And then you start on those really narrow roads and you're like, oh my gosh, like it takes forever to just go a few miles even.
Yeah, traversing and then you wind it back, you know, 50 years before there was an EU or anything. Yeah, like the journeys that these you know, pioneers went to, from like getting to Dublin to Lahinch on the West Coast, was not insignificant, to your point.
Now the story you know, really encompasses though this whole thing between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland, and I'm curious, like, was that your intention when you started to kind of highlight both, or was that something you discovered as you were filming and learning about the history?
Well, when I started it in like that very early stage of, you know, connecting with, you know, Kevin Cavey and Roger Steadman, you know, Kevin actually had published, I have it right.
Nice.
It's horrible to make this a reference to something visually on a podcast. Breaking the
rule. It's
called How Green Was Our Wave? And I actually have it on the film's website. And, but, you know, Kevin, you know, he was this kid from Dublin who kind of discovered, you know, had an epiphany of surfing in County Kerry when he was around 12 years old. And really kind of was a galvanizing moment that kind of transformed him. But, you know, your question of when I read this book, and this is now, you know, going on 4 years ago, he sent me a copy and was like, very generous. Hey, like, if I can help, let me know. You know, and I read the story and I was like, you know, the thing that jumped out at me was this was really at 68. To 72 was a lot of this foundation. And at that very moment was like, hey, that's when the Troubles conflict, you know, for those listeners who don't know about it, like, that was the conflict where really the a lot of, you know, is a conflict that lasted over 30 years, efforts of trying to, you know, it was a low, that for many years, it was the most, the longest running, you know, conflict in Europe between Northern Ireland, who have, you know, is under United Kingdom control, and the Republic of Ireland. When I saw that origin, 68 to 72, overlapped with the start of the Troubles, I was just like, that it strikes me as like something. I'm curious to see what's out there that's covered that. And when I started researching, obviously start looking at, hey, what other films have been done? And there had been some stories about Kevin and, you know, the origin, but really nothing covering those years, which to me, I was like, wow, it's like, it's funny. It's like, that to me seems like, and at that time I didn't know. I was like, hey, was there a member of their British Army who was a surfer, or a member of their IRA who was a surfer? You know, there very well could be. I didn't find that. Yeah. But what I did find was, hey, there were two distinct camps. Mm-hmm. And at the start, I was like, you know, obviously, as a filmmaker, you're kind of like, hey, what's the greatest drama you could work up? And I'm like, maybe there is something of a clandestine, you know, I'm thinking more of like a Jack Clancy novel.
Yeah.
But then I, you know, immediately I was like, hey, this could be an opportunity to just tell the story of those years through the prism of surfing. And that was kind of my goal from the outset. I was like, you know, I felt like, hey, you know, you could check out any big wave surfing, some great documentaries about Irish surfing that are more survey. Hey, like the story of like, hey, evolution up to big wave to Mullig Moore to now, like, great. And like, but myself, I would be able to add very little to that canon. And whereas my kind of target for a documentary for me is like, hey, learning something and hopefully opening up a world that maybe the audience is unfamiliar with. So that was kind of the goal always, to kind of hopefully shed light on that Troubles, but also kind of share it through a different lens, through the prism of surfing.
To me, it really was fascinating. You know, like, I feel like surfing is a great vehicle for telling a greater story. And you know, and to learn more about the Troubles and that era where it started, and how, you know, I really, really enjoyed like the context too, like how you liken the start of it almost to like civil rights movement too. You know, they took inspiration from that, and then the crackdown on the protests. Like, it really was interesting to see that beginning, and then at the same time see it almost like not affect the surfers, but affect the surfers, you know, like it was like, well, we just want to surf. And they were able to find that bond, you know, between surfing and like, I remember spending a lot of time in Bundoran and then being there, like when a lot of the people from the north would come down and like all the surfers from the north would come down, we would all hang out, and there was no issue there at all. It was really kind of nice and warm and welcoming in such a cool small community at the time. It was interesting. What I found fascinating, though, it seemed, were the surfers from the north were had this more core attitude and they almost didn't want the exposure to of surfing, whereas the surfers in the South almost wanted a more reputable, more kind of, they wanted recognition for surfing in Ireland. And like, I find it tells like a grander story of surfing in general, because like you have like a Fred Hemmings and a Drew Campion, you know, both, one was subversive and one wanted to be mainstream, and to see the two camps kind of play out in Ireland around that time too, I think is really fascinating.
Yeah, it was definitely, you know, when you're kind of looking for, I think in a narrative, you're looking for, hey, like hopefully strong characters that are, you know, charismatic, but also it's like, hey, if everybody just gets along, that's a great lineup to paddle out in, but maybe not a great story. And you know, and when I was researching it, I was like, you know, there was a time when I was like, I'd say I made a lot of progress quickly in the film, and then I got to a, quite frankly, a crossroads creatively, mm-hmm. where I was like, hey, it doesn't feel like there's enough to tell the story of, you know, this time right now, because there wasn't, you know, this person who is really involved, and there wasn't a real conflict in terms of, hey, what's your religious background, political background. But then when I kind of moved that to beat two and instead focused on the distinct worldviews of the, mm-hmm. the surfers, it actually came, I finished, when I kind of let myself off the hook of that, moving that up to the primary plot, and then also not being on the hook for a 90-minute film. Yeah. I finished in about, I started editing, like basically went to Long Island for a weekend, or actually a week out in like the far end of Long Island. And, you know, by first week of August, and was done with essentially, it's not the final edit by any means of the film, but the frame that I shared out with people was
structure.
It's kind of done, like 50 minutes of it was kind of, didn't change too much. But it was, it kind of really accelerated, because there was that great, to your point, the Dublin crew, and kind of Kevin Carey says this, which is wonderful as a filmmaker, have that quote. He said Ireland was a forgotten land in the middle of the water. You know, we wanted to put Ireland on the map and let everybody know we had surfing as good as anyone. A point of national pride.
Right.
And whereas, you know, the 18-year-olds, 19-year-olds, Davy Govan, Alan Duke, Martin Lloyd, who were like, you know, just students in university and art college, and, you know, studying like physics up in Queen's University in Belfast. They were like, all of a sudden these protests were breaking out, and they were like all of a sudden they've gone away to college, and first year in, they're living in an occupied war zone. They were like, hey, you know what? Their mind was not about, you know, putting it on the map. It was like, hey, like, let's just get to the waves and get out of here. You know, it was escape, you know, and that kind of accentuated it in terms of their, how they pursued the sport. And they also, I think the Northern crew, they realized how special that moment was to have like basically an island to themselves for, a period of time.
I also wonder, because of the protests and everything happening, there would be more of a countercultural vibe in general, and a mistrust of the greater whole of Europe coming to Ireland, and I imagine like that would affect their kind of outlook towards it. And they also were a little younger too. So I imagine those two things would actually probably.
I think you're right. There was like a reinforcement of that ethos, you know, in what they were going through. They were very counterculture. They were, some of the stuff I didn't get in the film, because I didn't, due to COVID and just the logistics of, you know, doing an independent film, that was like, you know, I was always under the assumption I was going to go back for longer interviews, and I never really had the opportunity. I kind of had to deal with, and I kind of just set my time frame to kind of get it finished about a year ago, June. I was like, I wanted to get to some festivals, and it just didn't work out. But I, of course, you having been in the film world, kind of heard, seen, you know, obviously a student yourself of this, you know, you think of the stories that don't get in. There's so many wonderful stories that we just couldn't get. Like,
of course,
you know, it's just
so much. It's insane.
Yeah, particularly dealing with Irish folks.
Totally. And God, they can tell a spin a yarn. Every story that comes out of their mouth just sounds so good. You know, you just throw a little accent to it and they could be like, I was just going to get a Coke and just happened to find a wave. And, you know, it just sounds magical, I feel like, for us.
Here It is. There's I listen to Jay Cooper, who's an editor who very fortunate to have, he came on after our crowdfunding campaign to help, I kind of handed over my edit, which I learned my editing skills from LinkedIn learning in terms of the free package on Avid. He came in and was Jay is from New Jersey, grew up down the shore. So he similar backgrounds of being tri-state area, but he was I would check in with Jay at the end of an editing day and he'd be like, God, I could listen to this guy, Davey Gobbin, all day. He's just such a good storyteller. Just his voice. It's there is something really nice about, I was very fortunate that I had some, great subjects in terms of telling stories.
And we will be right back. And now back to our show. It's amazing. And it also, to go back to I can also understand the surfers in Dublin, wanting to legitimize and wanting to take pride. And, as a surfer in New York, for years we were always treated, as backward waters, yep. Surfer magazine only had a little section for East Coast. And so I understand that whole wanting to show look, no, we have waves. And holy crap, Ireland does have I call it cold water Indo, it's it's phenomenal how many nooks and crannies there are there. But I can understand that pride. It's great because you then set this backdrop, to the 1972 Euro Surf Championships. And I love how that's almost the crescendo, the culmination of this whole film almost, where you have these two groups of surfers and one's kind of like, hey, I don't know if we should invite all of Europe here. And mm-hmm. not only that, this is all going on during the Troubles where pretty much most other sporting events were canceled in Ireland.
Yeah.
And people were scared to travel there. You had numerous bombings and other sorts of crazy events happen. So to see them then one try to put on a surf event in Ireland during all this was pretty ballsy and amazing. And I loved how this was that crescendo almost and how you kind of pulled that together.
Yeah. It felt like, I first feature film for me, but it's the thing I've heard from, as I relied on many experienced filmmakers to getting the ending, the start and the ending is so much of the film. And, and that was something which was tricky because it's it just felt like that, hey, that was, kind of limiting this film to an origin story, just keeping it. I mean, really, most of the activity is 68 to 72-ish.
Yeah.
Was, it just felt very clean to me that way, with that, because it was 72 was... it was the most violent year in terms of fatalities of the Troubles of the 35-year conflict. And to your point, there was the major, I did learn in the process that the one international sporting event that did take place that year was Ali came to Dublin.
Oh, yeah.
That movie's already been made, so I couldn't have a shot at that one, which I think is great. It's but there was really, and also I don't have them prominently featured, but that the British team came over.
Yeah,
was real. That was very unusual. That would be, at that time it was dangerous, to be, in Ireland, particularly, if you're not Catholic or, Irish Republican, from the Republic, down south, it could be, particularly if you're British. So it was, it felt like to me a good point. And also, with that was also the moment when this Eurosurf, that the biggest surf event in Europe at the time, the one that would put the eyes on the country and kind of formally take away the secret.
It's interesting, and like, not to spoil it for people, but like, you know, they have obstacles when putting this event on. Mother Nature doesn't fully cooperate. And I imagine like a lot of the Northern Irish surfers are like, yeah, serves you right, you know.
To your point, it's like the challenges of putting on a surf competition have not really changed in 50 years. The big thing is happening here, and competition is about to kick off here in California, and it looks like there's going to be some swell this week, but it's like, as you know, it's like we're not in charge. It's like it's to hold on a surf event or for a weekend, it's tricky.
Unless you're at Surf Ranch or Waco now.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. I forgot. We do have the pools now. Yeah, which is a different world.
But the other thing I just was so fucking stoked to see is Kevin Naughton. He is my ultimate hero. Like, I grew up idolizing him and Craig Peterson. And for our listeners, like, Kevin Naughton and Craig Peterson were the dynamic duo who traveled around the world and documented and explored and discovered a lot of spots. And they also set a tone for travel where it wasn't about exploiting. It was about keeping it under wraps and also respecting locals. And God, it is so cool to see him. So, I mean, what was that like connecting with him? And were you familiar much with him before making this, or was this something after the fact?
Yeah. Great question. And you, by far, you know, I've listened to your podcast and then the crew and you guys are deep end in terms of surf knowledge. I mean, you guys are PhD
nerds.
Level.
Nerds.
When I listen, I'm learning a ton. I appreciate that you know him, because I think that he, like, you know, the reality is, the way you credited Kevin is and Craig are absolutely right. They did really. Craig, he was the youngest surf photographer of Surfer Magazine ever. He's 16, and his mom would drive him around. I'm like, he's like, this is the ultimate gig of any 16-year-old to be like the official photographer for California in sophomore year of high school. His work, I'm very fortunate that, like, you know, some of the most beautiful stills in the film of Ireland, you know, that Craig
totally
was there at the time. It was great, you know, and the way I got connected with them was, it was really, that my first connection was Kevin Cavey, and then started really, I got connected with, as I mentioned, this Tremor 50th anniversary of the first Tremor contest, which was an Irish contest, not international. But it was really after spending time with the guys up and for the record, when I went to the 50th anniversary, the group that I heard all these stories, these names were coming up. There was only one, Bo Vance was the only one at the 50th anniversary.
Oh, wow.
Because I still don't think they really go to contests.
No.
You know, it's like 50 years in, they're kind of quite content up in Port Rush. And so when I went to there, but what I quickly realized, I went in like September to the Tremor thing, and I got like 11 interviews in 3 days, which was just naivete of a first time feature film, not overbooking it. And just not realizing the tax of that, but so glad I did, because, you know, some of them have passed and it's, what I quickly realized coming out of Tremor was like, the story is not going to go forward unless I get these so many of the story punchlines were like Alan Duke, Davy Govan. And, you were hearing these names, but Martin Lloyd and, but they weren't there. So I was like, the only way I felt like I could tell the story was going to them. And then once I went there, not unusual with Irish hospitality, you get to it might be hard tracking them down. That's just maybe a surf thing. You know, surfers are just hard to nail down, period. I don't care age or where you're from. It's but then when I was up with them, they were like, hey, have you spent time with Kevin Naughton? He's an American you should connect with. And they were all pointing me, and I was like, no, but I'm like, I love to. So I caught up with Kevin after the interviews with the principal Irish ones. Yeah. And then was out in Dana Point. It was great. Yeah, those guys are, Kevin is a natural storyteller, as you can tell. You know, he's just,
it's his, in his Irish blood, you know?
Yeah. I mean. And it was, you know, also to your point, it's like to have, you know, to have the Irish crew saying, hey, the waves are so good. It's, you know, there's a ton of subjectivity there, but like literally probably the one person at that time who could say that, you know, now obviously travel's much more commonplace, but like he and Craig were probably one of the two or maybe 10 people in the world who could say that, like, okay, we've surfed 15 countries and this is as good as anywhere. And you know, that's you know, to hear him still talk with that affectionately about, and the guy surfed everywhere, literally. And to feel, you know, to kind of still, you know, he gets very nostalgic at times. There's some beautiful moments he had with him just talking about his boards. And you know, he could see, it's like he very much, I love the way he talks about how special that time was in Ireland.
God, yeah. I mean, he, well, because I think he, one, like, he can validate it. Two, he also can, he saw what had happened in California, in Southern California, and probably knew going to Ireland, one day this could all end up like that. And probably with that foresight and knowledge, he could just suck the marrow out of it there, you know, and really, and really appreciate that, that quietness and that emptiness there for so long too, you know, because it, Ireland did not get on the map even after the 72 Euro Surf Championships. It still was pretty under the radar until Andrew Kidman's Litmus movie, which really thrust it there, and then Thicker Than Water by Jack Johnson, and like, and then after that, like, everything just started to snowball, and like, you had guys like Richie Fitzgerald up in Honduran who also was promoting it and getting exposure. So all of that stuff, like, it took until the late 90s, really.
Yeah,
until...
Step Into Liquid also.
Yeah, with exactly. There.
You know, it's like, it was, you know, it's that's when it was really, you know. Yeah, they as much as, you know, I point to, and I'll admit it, hey, there's some dramatic effect there, but, you know, hey, it's like, it was just, it was so unknown up to 72. And that was the beginning of the crack.
Yeah.
But it, to your point, if I think we were there in the 1980 to 85, it would be still, and honestly, you've been there in the 90s, it's still pretty darn good. Obviously, Bundoran, different story.
Yeah,
Eastie, I think, there too. But
you could still today find an empty spot there. Like, it's not, like, there are so many places you can go. And I think that's what's so cool about it. It's like, if you were to straighten out that coastline, like, it would stretch all the way around the world, you know. It's that curvy, and, you know, all sorts of like little bends and elbows everywhere.
It has a topography, and like, you know, when you talk to like Davey Govan, who's like, you know, he's surfer number one, but he's interested in everything. I remember walking in his house in Portrush, and it was like cold November day, like right before the Thanksgiving, and I'm like, you know, we'd sit out in the he was actually living just right at the edge of Causeway Coast, right at Giant's Causeway. He was like the last house before Giant's Causeway, which, for listeners who don't know it, it's like where, like, Houses of the Holy record, Led Zeppelin. It's one of the iconic international preserved heritage sites. You know, he sit with Davey, he's like, he knows geology. And like, they were counterculture up there, but like Davey was like, he's a scientist. He was like a physicist, and he said he did academics because he could get off the summers and surf, but the way he approached, hey, the geology, and like knew, like, hey, this, there's some amazing slabs here that are just going to generate waves, and like all the point breaks. It was, Yeah, it was great. It's great to kind of hear their perspective on it and like the way they went about it. Because your point, it's like it's a unique. You know, they're blessed with a ton of unique, every variety of break you could want, as long as there's energy in the water. And that's the part that is, you know, we deal with on the Atlantic.
Yeah, exactly. And this is killing me. I'm forgetting their name. The surfer who, you know, who organized the 72 International. What was his name?
Kevin or Roger.
Roger.
Kevin and Harry Evans too.
Yeah, the one who ended up having to move to Calgary.
Oh, Calgary, Kevin.
Oh, can you let our listeners know a little bit of that? And I'm curious, like, what happened to him, basically?
Yeah, I mean, Kevin, so Kevin, for context, for those of the folks who, he was this kid from Dublin who kind of grew up, kind of like dreaming about California and the West Coast, you know, even before, and, has this moment when he's 12 about, he's seeing some imagery of surf waves on a Reader's Digest, and basically kind of from that point on has this moment where it's like that's what he's going to do for the next. He wants to become a surfer because he's been obsessed with California culture. He's going to transform himself, and he does. You look at pictures of him, he's like, he looks like the part of a surfer. It's basically spends from like 62 when he's like, say 12-ish to 72, making it his mission to become, he founds the Irish Surfing Association with a few others. He represents Ireland, the first contest. It's great. I think I have a post on my Instagram. Like, he was the only surfer in Ireland, he was sending stuff on like official, like, paper letterhead crazy. That he was like, and he went to San Diego, competed for Ireland, kind of putting it on the letterhead. Meanwhile, that they're like, oh, we're super stoked to have the Irish Surfing Association reaching out. Meanwhile, it's him in his attic at the hotel sending it off, and like to have that archive piece is like wonderful. And I really don't even hit on this, but then he kind of makes it happen. He does make it happen. He sets up the first importer. They import these boards from Bilbo in the UK, which is a pretty big board maker in the 60s. So they become the official importer of boards. And then starts, getting, he's very much a cheerleader still. I mean, I talked to him Friday. He was headed to Lahinch, and he's now 81, 82. And I'm like, wow. He's like, I'm not sure how the waves are going to be. And I'm like, God, I still find it so inspiring. But but his family was in tourism, and, he was, definitely, upper middle class, he's like, family's hotel had done extraordinarily well. His father was an entrepreneur. They wound up building a pretty big hotel in Bray, Ireland, on the Irish Sea, called the Starlight Hotel. They kind of do this huge expansion right before like 70. Uh-huh. And it was just when like every, or even closer to 68. And it was like, they were, like he was going, representing the hotel in America, going, traveling abroad. And then all of a sudden, the troubles, we mentioned earlier, it's like they, a very large percentage of their customer base was from Belfast and the UK. Wow. And and virtually, what happens is, well, kind of give it away a little bit, but it's their largest customer was firebombed, the bus company, which was not uncommon, kind of targeting British oriented businesses, in the conflict. And, in the span of a few years, went from like well-to-do, well-heeled, extremely bright future to, not even like, hey, like taking a step back. They had to, bank took control of the whole hotel. And, it's not uncommon. It's a very, unfortunately, it's a very Irish story that like, it's like they had to leave the country because there was no opportunities. Tourism virtually dried up. it would come back in late 70s and 80s, kind of as they pivoted to America to fill the gap. But he had to work in Calgary, you know, in Canada at a resort. He worked at a resort. And the part that when he wrote, the part that I was like to myself, that I was like, he sold all his boards. And it was just like, you know, and it was like that to me was like, when I kind of threw that out with some of the folks who were involved in the project, they were not surfers. And I was like, yeah, I can't understand how painful that is. You know, it's also because he's not like he's 60, 70.
Yeah.
And he wasn't done with surfing, but he had to let it go. And it, and like that was kind of a heartbreaking moment. But, you know, they spent several years in Canada. And as the economy started to come back in he was back in, I don't have the exact date, but I think he was back in Ireland by around 80. So basically, part of the most of the 70s was spent in Canada. And then, you know, he amazingly, you know, he kind of picked up right where he left off. He, you know, a guy is an inspiration about how much he surfs. I can't count how many times, you know, I'd call up and he's like, oh, no, Kev, you just missed him. He's out surfing. And I'm like, guy's making me look bad. I'm like, here I am, like 40s, trying to hang in, and I'm like trying to get my time in the water, and I like this 70, 80 year old guy is just doing laps around me. That was the moment where it's like when Kevin's story is, you know, it's definitely one of the here he was also, he lived a life very outside and unaffected by the troubles up to that point. You know, it was like Dublin and Belfast are about, I think, just over 100 miles from each other, not even. But, you know, they're different worlds in terms of at that time, you know. So it was, you know, when I was kind of that part of the story, I felt like also in the stories of his, he had been featured in a few documentaries. And I was like, you know, it's like, hey, that's, you know, that's a big part of it, that like, hey, the guy who brought it here, you know,
had to almost leave in almost exiled, you know, in some ways, and go not just exile, but go somewhere where there's no surf. Like, I would have thought, you know, in his 20s, he probably would have just like gone to California or would have like, you know, just surf traveled. But he had like duty to his family, which is sounds really impressive, actually.
Yeah, he was a young father, I think one child at the time, and another on the way. And that was it was a decision they made. But the he came back, and you know, he's lived an extraordinary life. You know, he like, you know, to have his fingerprints all over the arrival of surfing, that's an amazing accomplishment. But he's done so much, you know, since coming back. He's and he is truly a wonderful spirit to be around. You know, I've had the pleasure of surfing with him and a few of these guys. Really, he and Davey are the ones I've surfed with. And it's, you know, wonderful. It's contagious to me as, you know, a surfer, just to like, yeah, I hope I can be as stoked when I'm like 70, 80 and keeping at it.
And we will be right back. And now back to our show. Did you score good waves when you were there, by the way?
I feel like I have to go back. I'm like, this movie has to get distributed in Ireland for no other fact that like, I have to get back and get a really good session. I had the time we went out with Kevin, which is kind of the end of the film in Sligo, which has a powerful personal connection to me. Beautiful spot. But it was kind of dying, the swell. And then I surfed, actually during interviews of Willie Britton led me aboard, and I surfed up in Donegal, which was pretty great. It was super fun. Didn't do Bundoran. I'm drawing a blank. What's the break just north on the bluff there? It's
Tullin Strand.
Tullin. Thank you. So
it's right by the ferry bridges.
Yeah, exactly.
Which I've jumped off naked for some reason.
Oh, nice.
Yeah,
nice.
Real good time. TMI, sorry.
Folks. No, it's all good. This is an adult podcast. That was great. And then I surfed with Davey. It was a huge swell, actually, when I just after the Belfast premiere last November, we did a screening up in Port Rush at an old Art Deco theater. And it was a huge swell. It was like bigger than I can, you know, there's a reason why you don't see a lot of surfing in me in the film. It's like, you talk about an editorial choice, very little be added with my, you know, stance on the, but we went in, at a protected spot because it was a solid 10 foot, 12 feet, and just ripping. But we went out these, I think it's the bath houses. I forget the exact name of this break, but it's one of the many protected breaks around Port Rush. And it was super fun. He let me, you know, one of his very old boards, which was super fun just to ride, you know, one of these old boards. And that was a great, you know, cause I was the basically back to back. I kind of went one night premiere of Belfast, the next night on the coast. And it was just cool to see, like, from a theater, rather a film festival reception, and then kind of taking up to the coast the next night. I was very much, by the time I got on the plane to go to Dhaka, NYC, I was obviously nervous before those, but I was like, it felt relaxed because I was like, well, no matter what happens at Dhaka, NYC, I'm like, I'll always have Port Rush.
Yeah. You know, it's the people who are in it and the locals to get their approval. That's like the most important, you know. You've known you've done a good job when they've appreciated it. You know, the rest of the stuff is easy after that, you know.
It felt really nice, you know, because to your point, it's like you make a film, you're like, there's an audience within the audience, and like they had not seen anything that I'd done, and I'd gone away several years, and then I come back with this. You're like, is this going to hit the mark? And I've been very stoked with and I'm humbled by the reception so far of the film.
I loved it. It to me, it had, and this is a compliment, like a very nice PBS quality to it, like in a good, like very positive, almost Ken Burnsian way, you know, how it's done and the footage and the narration and, you know, the writing is great. Like it's, you know, I've seen a lot of surf films and this was really nice, actually really well done in how it told the story. And I think like a lot of people at the festival are going to really appreciate it and really enjoy it.
I appreciate that. And, little spoiler, Yeah, PBS is going to, I'm pretty far down the discussion. I'll be announcing something with PBS pretty soon. So
see, I had the eye, I saw solid. It already.
Instincts, I don't know if you work for PBS. Maybe this is all set up. But
I wish, but yeah. No, I just saw it. I was like, this makes sense there for sure.
Yeah, no, I'm stoked. I'm excited. So I have some news soon for October, actually. So coming up quick.
Phenomenal. So with that, we can see this at the Rockaway Film Festival this Thursday. So I'm going to post this as quick as possible and get it out there. Where can our listeners find it otherwise or find information on it, on the film? Keep it a secret.
So right now we are kind of finalizing, excited to have like a initial broadcast, regional broadcast coming up next month. So that'll be... coming soon, but then right now we're still nailing down. The nice thing about, you know, having been forced to have a broadcast date now, I've now cleared everything, you know, the licensing of some of the stuff. I kind of just had a festival license. So right now go to, you can follow on Instagram, and then keepitasecretfilm.com. I'm posting regular updates there. You know, what I'm feeling like more confident is like, hey, hopefully, I'm going to have more announcements around PBS. This starting with a regional release. And then also, you know, the nice thing is now I kind of have all of the rights cleared so I can actually do more screenings outside of festival, because I've had a lot of reach outs. Shout out to Dave and Longboard Ireland, who are screening it at O'Connor's in Kerry, County Kerry on Saturday, part of Logjam. 2022. And then, you know, I honestly, this is all, that we're starting to talk about broadcasts before I was anticipating a 1 year festival run, and we're not really done. We have New York Rockaway this Thursday at 9 p.m. Then we have it's going to Australia Irish Film Festival end of a few weeks, and then Newport Beach Film Festival.
Oh, perfect. Awesome.
The beginning of October, right? I think the 16th, I believe it is. And then it's going to Santa Cruz Film Festival, and then a few others we have in the. So there'll be some festivals, but then also, you know, hopefully we just have it on a streaming service very soon. Yeah.
Well, congratulations. And, you know, I was told to say this if I ever paddled out an Irish lineup or if someone said something to me, I don't know, maybe you might know this. They'd say, come as a tattoo. And you're supposed to say, Tommy Gama. And it's supposed to, I don't know. I was Gaelic, which means, how's it going? It's going well, you know, something along those lines. Someone might correct me on this.
Well, I
how's your Gaelic?
Now you've lapped me on number one surf knowledge tower, which I'm going to try to compete with you. But now Gaelic, I'm like, why weren't you an associate producer 4 years ago? I could have finished this film way sooner. I'm like, I just kicked myself that we didn't connect until, you know, 2022 at the end of a festival run.
Next project, you let me know.
All right, keep the secret too. I'm going to lock you up.
Awesome.
The deeper secrets.
Sean, thank you so much. Really appreciate it. And congratulations. And again, super stoked on this film. So thank you again for sharing it with me. And thank you for producing. This is amazing.
Thanks so much. Really appreciate it.
Awesome. And for our listeners, you can, of course, follow us at Swell Season Surf Radio on Instagram or go to swellseasonsurfradio.com. And we'll catch you all down the line soon.